First of all, thank you very much for all coming. That's really, really great. The pandemic had so many bad sides to it, obviously, but this is a new feature, a new format, and seeing so many wonderful people here in front of me, their faces at this time. And I'm just so happy and pleased. Of course, I'm very much looking forward to meeting, to being with many of you in person in a few weeks. And that's just wonderful. I should also say that today is May the 2nd, and that means we're just a couple of days away from a very important date, and I will obviously feature that in a number of places. But before I get to that prequel, this year, I mean, in some sense, virtually, this is a talk at NYU. So I should really make an effort to reference some historic work that has been done there. So this was Schwartz and Scharrer, 1983, so that was 40 years ago. And this was one version of the piano mover's problem up there, you see that, coordinating the motion of several independent body. So it's very appropriate to reference that. I should also mention there's a bit of personal history to this, because this kind of work, Piano Mover's Problems, the series of these papers, were probably some of my very earliest encounters with computational geometry. So if you think that some of the things I will be doing is not really computational geometry, you know who to blame. And Boris was referencing, saying like, yeah, there's some application stuff related to CG Week and so on and so on. So we, for the last few years, the first time we did this was in 2019 when CG Week was way over in Portland, great place, good location, good people. And since then we've run this every year. This is a challenge, this is an application challenge. You have a problem, an optimization problem from geometry, and the mission that people choose to accept is not proving theorems about these things, but actually solving instances as well as they can. And this was the challenge 2 years ago. So you have a bunch of things which are in their initial locations marked in green, numbered, so these are labeled, and these need to go here and these need to go here, and so that kind of thing. Or we'll get to that a little later. Episode one. Okay, I need to make sure this works, because like I said, we're 2 days away from May the 4th, and I hope that works now. Play. Yeah, I hope that you got the sound and you know what this is about. So when you look at this kind of thing, this kind of structure, so that's not a moon, that's no moon, we know that, building big things in space. And this is okay, that's science fiction, but sometimes you read science fiction in serious publications and there's even governments making statements about this. I mean, we're dealing with climate crisis. Let me try to change those lights. Climate crisis and all sorts of things. Where do we generate? How do we generate energy? So there is this idea of building a solar power station out there and could supply the world and so on. And yeah, something like this, bring it down. And here, government, the UK Space Agency, this is from last September. So it's fairly recent. And the question is, how would you build something like that out there? The largest thing that we've built in space is obviously the ISS. That's about 100 meters in size, and it took 20 years and 100 billion, give or take, to build this. How do you scale this kind of thing? And there are a number of aspects to it. So if you think about this, scale it down, and then have 100 of those, that's a square kilometer. And if you scale that again, bang, That's that. And if you scale that again, and you do that again, and then you get to something like that in that size. And obviously that's just 2D, so 3D, that's really, really huge. So building anything of that size in space is a fundamental challenge, and not just in geometry or robotics, but just physics, because that's a lot of mass. How do you get all that mass out into space? And well, building some things in this kind of dimensions, you want ultra-light materials that are discrete. So you can have these things now where basically they have out in the vacuum, the density of these things. If you build these structures and you see there's Ben Janet standing on top of that bridge, so it does carry weight. The mean density is lower than air. And so that means you can actually do a lot of these things. And then the question is, if you bring that out into space and you want to build good structures, how do you actually assemble that kind of stuff? And that gets us to this kind of thing that's also from MIT/NASA, where they have these robots that can work on the walk on these structures. And you see that's because it's discrete, accuracy is not such a big problem because that sort of self-corrects locally. And of course, you can also see that this really has a lot to do with the kind of things we're considering in our field. It's geometric, it's discrete, there are vertices, it's 3D, yeah, geometry all over. And then, of course, you can have these robots that carry around stuff and rearrange and rebuild these things. So that's quite fascinating. And then the question is always scaling and scalability. So here are a bunch of images. That's from the lab in Houston from Aaron Becker, who's been visiting me for the last 2 years. And you see there's it's the same kind of robot architecture that builds stuff here, white on red, so you can see that. Those are actually the University of Houston colors. And if you go from this a step to simulation, of course, then you see, okay, that's sort of basically the same thing, simulated. And if you go one more step, then you get this, you have these cells and you have these robots that go around on these voxels or pixels here in 2D projection. And if you want to have these really, really simple robots that do things, then what's the simplest you can come up with? I mean, these robots, you want many of these robots, you don't want sophisticated computers to run them, having very simple operations to perform certain things. So you could think of these, here these pixels or voxels, and then you have these robots that take on different states. So these are, as you saw in this prequel, finite automata that can do things. So for instance, go around and build a bounding box to this particular shape based on a limited number of states and operations, and keep the whole thing connected, and there's a marker and so on and so on. And you can go a little bit further with this. So here's the next thing, next challenge. Here you have this kind of thing and you want to scale this up. Build a copy of this thing over here with just a couple of these finite automata robots that move around. So finite automata, not in theory on a Turing machine tape or something like this, but things moving around doing geometric operations with very, very limited information, basically using the arrangement itself as storage space and so on. So let's run this a little bit. Step on my... And you see that. Some of you may have seen bits and pieces of what I'm presenting here today. Boris told me, like, yeah, just bring a variety of things and those kind of things. So, I mean, this is finite automata. Okay, you can do these things in geometry. But of course, there are a few other aspects to it. So here's something in between episode 1 and episode 2, space ants. space and story. So if you actually have these objects, robots or tinier creatures, then you may want to look at really, really small scale. And you see here, this is a 40th of a millimeter. That's really, really small. The thing is, if you make these robots or these moving objects really smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, I mean, the nanobots appears in the New York Times spelling bee. So that's a legitimate word. And if that's a legitimate word, that's a legitimate concept. If you want to build nanobots all the way down, now you have to face the fact that as you scale it down, the volume drops with a third power, which means that the volume available to store energy and do computation or do any kind of active motion really, really drops down fast. Whereas the surface area, which is where you have to overcome the resistance against the outside medium, that only drops with a second power. And at really, really small scales, the medium resistance, that's a funny thing. So, you have to face that if you want to send like really, really small things, for instance, through the body, through the bloodstream to get to certain places. Energy storage and control and all that becomes a problem. So what you can do is you use an outside force. And the funny thing is with this thing, that's a particular microorganism, is you can feed that some nutrition, and that if you lace it with iron, then they have iron particles inside, and you can use an external force like this. And if you turn this on and you can switch it on, you can use that force to move things around like that. And they will move in this synchronized fashion, like this one here. And piano mover's problem, of course, that's also something that we brought here. That's a piano, a small piano. And these green dots here are so-called kilobots. These are really like, they're about the size of a dime or so, a quarter rather. And they're really, really simple robots, hundreds of them, if not thousands. And you can control these with an external light source. So you see there's a light here, there's a light. And so you can orient them to the light, and then they will do these local things. They will sort of do this and go around here. They can push that piano. So you can use an external light, external control from here to make these robots go here and push the piano and move it here. But changing the direction, you can sort of move it around. I mean, this is a speed up version of it, but you see how that goes with the swarm. Okay. That's a natural thing. We use an external force to control things, but then you're facing some algorithmic issues, because if you look at this configuration, which is a shape A, the red one is a letter A, and if you use a global force to move it, and this and down and over, then you see that does not change the relative configuration of this, and it stays an A. What happens if you want to reconfigure this because you want to build a different shape or display a different letter and so on? And that's where you need to do something algorithmic, geometric, to break symmetry and control what the shape and what the outcome is. So here's a, you see that's actually something filmed, and you have these on this board, you have these white and silver balls. You see that's a shape A. And here's some pins which are obstacles. And now we're going to activate an external force called gravity by tilting this. And you see that rolls until it hits an obstacle. You roll it over until it hits an obstacle or another object. Come on. And then you go down. And over. Bang, and you see that A has turned into a B. As it turns out, you can do arbitrary permutations with this way. So here's the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And if you do this, you have a clockwise and a counterclockwise permutation. So if you do this, then you just switch the first and two, the first, second. And if you do it counterclockwise, you do a cyclic permutation. So you have these two generators and you can do any kind of permutation by just going clockwise and counterclockwise. And that allows you to completely reconfigure anything you want by just using a global force. You don't have to touch these things individually. You just let them run through this whole thing. And that's one way of doing it. Of course, there's a bit more to be said here. There are a number of algorithmic problems here. There are a number of applications. I'll show you in a couple of slides. I'll show you some more of those. The main purpose, of course, is not to run you down all the details of all this, but you can imagine there's a lot of combinatorics. There's a lot of algorithms. There's a lot of geometry involved. Let me just quickly hint at a second different way of breaking symmetry, and that is going to use not obstacles, but it's going to use boundary friction. So when, as you move here, you move that, and then the red one will hit the boundary here, and then the blue one, you see that slides over and it changes the relative configuration. And there's more that you can do. Of course, you can look at like what's the angle that corresponds to that friction. And as you go, there's certain things you can do here. There are different ways of using this, of rearranging this configuration here and here and here. No details on this one here, but let me just show you that you can use boundary friction here to completely sort this kind of thing through a series of motions there. And you can actually use that in real life. So that's a camera. This is, again, Baron Becker has worked on these kind of things. And yeah, so there's a bit more that you can do here. You see that's a triangular shape. There's a blue particle and there's a red particle. And as you will see in a moment, you can completely rearrange these any way you like by using boundary friction if you understand the geometry behind that. Yeah, so that was a cow stomach, and you can imagine there are applications in environments that are hard to reach. If you have an outside force, like a magnetic force, that can sort of rearrange these things. Here's a paper that we had. This was called about talking about targeted drug delivery. So that's a brain, and if you want to get certain particles to the right places, the classical traditional way is to use your bloodstream. You put in the poisonous chemicals and you hope that it reaches everywhere, including where the tumor here. But of course, it's obviously a much better idea to take these particles and to gather them in the critical area and not all over your body. And there are a number of obviously also geometric and algorithmic problems with that. There's another thing that you can do with small scales. You can try to build things, which is a theme that we're pursuing here, obviously. So you can use this and have particles that stick together. So that could look like this here. This is somewhere there's a scale. So that's about millimeter scale. And you have these little particles that you can move around in this labyrinth and they stick together and you can build little small scale stuff. And you can do it systematically, not just have this one thing that you build, but you can have this factory like micro factories. And if you pipeline this whole thing, then you get an output where basically every four moves or so on, you get a new thing outside after going through a production line. Okay, let's move on. Episode two, many objects to coordinate. And zoom in and you see there's a lot of stuff moving around.
Simultaneously steering a large number of agents to goal positions is a common challenge, whether you are an ant army trying to defend your home, just trying to get home after work, a densely packed warehouse of robots delivering products to be packed and shipped, or a marching band demonstrating your skills.
So obviously that has a lot of different applications coordinating all these things. And in this theme of robots, people have looked at this. This is something that got a lot of attention a few years ago. This was here, these are again, these nanobots, and you see there's a speed up factor of 60, here's a speed up factor of 40. So building a large shape out of these robots, and they move around, but what we want to do is do it this way. I will just quickly go back a moment here. So when you just look at this and what you will see again is that these are basically moving one at a time to build a big shape. And I talked to the person who actually ran the experiment. He said he never had so much coffee in those 24 hours to make sure this worked, because that's how long that took, that reconfiguration took. Speed up factor 60, speed up factor 40, and this is basically one at a time. And what we're trying to do is use parallelism, and that's this one here. So everything moves at once in parallel. That's how human society works when it does work. People do things in parallel in a coordinated fashion, or actually in a synergetic fashion, not one waiting for one person to finish their job and then do the next. This is also how you do this reconfiguration here, this into that, or another transition from here to here. It's the same number of pixels, and you see that you have a origin and a destination for each of those by color. And of course, you don't want to have one at a time move one to the final destination, but you want to do this in a coordinated way. And that was the challenge we had a couple of years ago. So the way this works is when you look at this, if you want to swap the zero and the one, these are too big to pass by each other. So what instead you can do is you can do a little line dance or the little ring dance here, have those swap and have those swap and have those swap. For those of you who remember that, that's a bit like a Rubik's Cube kind of combination of motions. So let's run this and see what happens. And you see zero and one are exchanged. And if you do this, you can do this in parallel in multiple places at the same time. And what we want to do is get order into this that you do these little exchanges and use some exchanges, but these kind of things, so you can take six and do these local simulation. And you want to do all of that stuff in parallel, all of that to reach that. And you see we got that here. The idea is, when you have this kind of situation, you want to get from an origin to a destination in parallel, collision free. So you may have to go around. If the largest distance, Manhattan distance, we're at NYU, the largest distance is something like a D, then you have a lower bound of how long it takes to get everybody from their origin to their destination. That is a D. I mean, you need to travel at distance, so it's got to be a D. The question is, can you coordinate it so well that everybody is at their final destination in O of D? If you take one and then another and then another, then it blows up in a big way. Can you do the choreography so carefully, so systematically, algorithmically, that you can get an O of D? And I will run you through a few animations to give you an idea of how that whole thing works. The idea is that you want to get all these into their target subtile of the whole arrangement. So that's the D. Within each of these, you can do local things, which are basically two-dimensional versions of bubble sort or so, odd-even sort. You swap this way, you swap that way. And they are classical algorithms from way back that you can reconfigure anything here in size in a number of steps, which is O of D, if that is within its right cell. But if you take the whole thing, then you're an O of N, and that's much bigger than O of D. So the idea is to get everybody into some of these subtiles. And that means we have two steps for this whole thing. One is to make sure, when you look at this, that everybody gets to their right location. That's a flow problem, really, because you put some in here, you put some over there, so there's a circulation, there's a flow problem. And then once you have everybody in their right position, then you want to do this local thing within each cell. And so we get this kind of flow situation where you go from neighboring adjacent cells to the others, which you can then implement something like this. So there's some local motions, you sort this flow, you coordinate this, and then they don't overlap and move along here. And yeah, there are a few things that you can do here. Just quickly run through that without too much hassle. So there's some icons that say, yeah, here's some subroutines that we're using. And the idea is that you want to take this whole arrangement of all these paths, like this goes to here and this goes to here, all the circulations, and decompose that into layers that do not cross, because the crossing is obviously the problem. So if you have this kind of circulations all around and crosses here, you can rearrange, decompose that by basically peeling off layers of this and that and that and that and that. So on, so on, and then you can carry this out and decompose that as well. And you have a bunch of non-crossing little things which you can then implement by having these local rearrangements of the robots in this macroscopic scenario. And yeah, there's different layers and depth and all that. And you get an overall situation where this is one part of it. So there's an iconography about the different steps of how you do this whole thing, and then of course realize these flows, send these in, send these over. Those are sort of the main ideas of pushing this across the boundary to the next one. So these two states, once you get everybody into their right little subtile, and then you can use these local operations. And like this, and like this, and like this, and like that. That's where this happens, and then we're fine. And a few more things, you see that stacks. So, some outcome, there's this paper, Eric was a co-author on this, and a few people from here. Some of you may remember Henk. Last time I talked to him, he was just coming back from Gibraltar. He's traveling at this point, he's well, sends his regards. That kind of thing gets you into this kind of thing. Now there are a few more aspects here. This is sort of a main theorem that says if you have this kind of arrangement and the maximum Manhattan distance, which is the lower bound on the time it takes to do all this reconfiguration, is d, then you can actually convert one into the other in O of d. Okay, great. But the question is, can you always do that? Or is that an artifact of how the cells work? Are there more geometric arrangements where you encounter some extra obstacles? What if you take these disks and don't have them in orthogonal lattice, but maybe something even denser, hexagonal, where it's sort of tight, densest disk packing and so on? And it turns out And let me show you that when you have this kind of arrangement here, it's layers of red and blue disks, and they need to go clockwise or counterclockwise, like gears, in opposite directions. Then you see that these, for instance, this red hexagon of disks here, that cannot just simply rotate like that because it's kind of stuck in between the blue layers. So you need to pull this whole thing apart to have enough space to make that rearrangement and to that reconfiguration. So if you want to move these counterclockwise and those clockwise and these counterclockwise, so then it turns out that this takes more effort and this takes more time because you need to make space for them to get by each other. If they're clustered too densely, then you can show that the amount of space that you need is actually no longer constant times the minimum distance, which is the maximum distance, which is just one unit disk to the next. You need to make enough space, which is non-constant, and you can do this kind of thing. And as you move this around, now that works. Okay, that's a feasible solution to doing this reconfiguration. But as you do this expansion and contraction, you can follow the Voronoi cell of this particular disk, and they can argue that it needs to have a certain volume, a certain area. And that means that's only possible if you move everything apart and there's a lower bound of omega of fourth root of n for the factor times which you have the minimum distance or the stretch of this whole thing. So there's a theorem that says, okay, for certain arrangements, there is a non-constant lower bound, which is omega of n to the 1/4. Now you could say that, yeah, this is a complicated, this is a big arrangement, and things are complicated, but let me show you something which is relatively small and relatively innocent looking. This is a situation when you have, and so just look at this one thing, you have a blue disk and a red disk, and the final destination of the red disk is down here. The blue disk should in the end be in the same location as it was in the beginning. What is the best pair of trajectories? So you could do this, you could move around, just move around like this. And if this is a unit radius, you see there's a certain certain distance that you travel. But there's some more intricate trajectories which do a bit more coordination. The blue steps out away a bit to make space for the red one, so it has a more efficient, more direct path. And there are different ways of doing it, right? So this could just go around down here, but here you have two smaller cyclic paths, and you see what you see here on the right. On the very right, you have this kind of shape and you have that kind of trajectory. And now I will hit play and run these trajectories, and you will see who wins. Almost there. Done, 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 and done. And you see that's quite a gap between 4.16 and 6.283. And that's actually a trajectory that we only computed numerically. Even if you just have two disks, one needs to get to the other side, you get messy trajectories where we don't have a closed form solution, just a numerical solution. And that already tells you that really solving these things optimally with all these shapes, it's really, really difficult. I mean, these problems are NP hard and all that, but doing this well, that's not so clear. There's a lot of geometry hidden here. Okay, I said episode 2, but I haven't shown you episode 2 yet, so let's do that. Okay, so you saw a few things. This was, again, no moon, but it was also not a death star. These are little devices or little things called catoms. Catoms come from computational atoms, programmable matter. These are things, you saw these things moving in themselves, like expanding and contracting, moving around. They can interact with their neighbors, they can help each other. They can have energy supply, so that's a way to have this energy supply, because they hook up and you can run electric currents and all that. And you can build things like macrostructures like this. All good and fine, but here's one issue, and you saw that when the video was slowed down, that was connectivity. So if I give you this arrangement here, you see that, and here's one extra thing, this little s here, and I want to move it to here from S to T, and that is a bit like what I just showed you before. I mean, you just move this thing over here, but moving that thing over here along this path A is no good in this situation, because you lose connectivity to the rest of the swarm, which is a bad thing for little devices that need to stay in contact to get routing guidance, but also energy supply. It's also a bad idea in space, because anything that loses connectivity may drift off to infinity and beyond. So of course you could say, like, okay, let's keep that connected, bang, bang, bang. But that could be potentially a huge detour. And that is costly, and we don't want that. So the question is, can you do this any better? And you can, and we get again this issue of coordination, because if you look at this and you coordinate these to move together and move apart, bang, like this, you do a handover, and the total distance, so the time it takes to move this is actually the same as in this path. But now, of course, you see this is no longer an issue of just one particle moving over, it's a whole big coordination. It takes the whole village here to move this one guy across. That, of course, promises complicated algorithms. This promises complicated geometry. And it's not surprising that this turns out to be hard. And that's a reduction where even if you just want to do it in two steps, but stay connected, this is really difficult and complicated, and there's this is layers of this construction of how this works. Now we're going to zoom in a little bit. You see that arrangement and see that how that plays out with robots, and you can see small scale and large scale, this NP hardness construction here. That was a few more things. One more thing is that you can, of course, again, use coordination and use algorithms, not just to show that it's hard, but you can also achieve algorithmic results of a positive nature. And for that, this is a cup of coffee, and this cup of coffee consists of individual particles. We want to reconfigure them into a different shape, into sausage. And doing this by local rearrangement that maintains connectivity of this whole thing, that does this in constant stretch. So the whole time it takes is within a constant of the initial distance. Now, mind you, this whole thing is unlabeled. This is all red, all good. I will, to round this off in the time that I agreed to with Boris, show you a little animation of how this whole thing plays out. We have, of course, some theorems and algorithms that show how you do this with any kind of configuration from start to a given finish. And let's run that. So there's some scaffolding being built out of this. And then these things move to their respective subcells, and they, within each cell, they assume a certain shape, and then you see what this whole thing was trying to be. That was last year's sausage that we had that in that video here. And yeah, with that, some final credits.